ओम श्री साई राम। ऑफरिंग माय मोस्ट प्रेयरफुल सैल्यूटेशंस एट भगवान्स लोटस फीट, कन्वेइंग माय हार्टफुल साई राम टू ईच एंड एवरी पार्टिसिपेंट लिसनर्स, आई वुड लाइक टू शेयर सम ऑफ माय थॉट्स टुडे विद ऑल ऑफ यू ऑन ए वेरी रेलेवेंट and a very important topic, namely, what can truly sanctify our lives? It is very relevant actually that we work towards sanctifying our lives. Life is, according to Swami, a very precious gift. And we are here for a short while. During that period of time when we are on this planet, according to scriptures, we need to conduct ourselves in such a way that we do not again come back. In the sense, how do we escape from the cycle of birth and death? We need to work towards this because it is clearly stated that it is janma dukham jara dukham, come what may. Whatever possessions a human being may be having in this world, maybe you are wealthy, maybe you are healthy, you have all kinds of opportunities available to you to lead a comfortable life, but still life is considered to be a highly complicated exercise. That's why many people describe it as life is not a bed of roses. So, life within carries lot of frustrations, lot of agonies, lot of anxieties, lot of issues. But at the same time, it is possible for us to lead a life of calm, a life of quietness, a life of joy, and also a life by which we can work towards fulfillment of our journey on this planet. How do we do that? Bhagavan Baba, on a number of occasions, mentioned to all of us that life is a gift of God. It's a gift of God. So, there is no choice probably for us except to work on the righteous path so that life gets sanctified. How do we do that? Bhagavan in a number of discourses clearly mentioned that the most important principle that governs human life is Jantunam Narajanma Durlabham. Jantunam Narajanma Durlabham, when it is explained by many scholars, they go to the conclusion that human life is difficult to get. So human life is precious, and to be a human being is really a great gift of God. But when Bhagavan Baba was explaining this concept to us, he said, it is said, Jantunam Narajanma Durlabham means, it is not that it is simply a unique opportunity to be a human being, but also we need to understand the word Jantunam Narajanma Durlabham. When the word jantunam is used, It also sounds probably that man is also an animal. Man is also an animal when it is said. We need to contemplate a bit and understand all the animal qualities that are there in us. There are a lot of animal qualities in us. These animal qualities are to be conquered. Is it possible actually for human beings to conquer all these animal qualities and cultivate divine qualities? Is a very tough question. When we talk about animal qualities, there are lots and lots of qualities, but basically we talk about Arishadvargas. Arishadvargas, Swami extensively spoke and said how these Arishadvargas do not allow us to sanctify our life. Arishadvargas, when we talk, Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Mada, Moha, Matsarya. Adi Shankaracharya also spoke extensively on that. And in human life, many of us who are interested in leading a spiritual life, we would like to have some sort of a control over these Arishadvargas and put ourselves on the spiritual path. India probably is a unique land in the entire world where spirituality runs through the blood of people in this country. Ancient times, through Vedas, Upanishads, Itihasas, Puranas, lot of saints, sages, seers, and all of them gave us so much of wisdom, so much of wisdom. For us to sanctify our lives, to cultivate wisdom, that is the idea. If you want to cultivate wisdom and utilize it in your regular life, first you need to get educated. That is the reason why Bhagavan Baba gave a lot of importance to education. When once you educate yourself, there is a possibility of seeing the light, getting out of the darkness in which we live. Darkness is called nothing but avidya, ajnana. From ajnana to jnana. For that we need education. And Swami, by starting lots and lots of educational institutions, by gifting the world with programs like Balavikas and so many other programs, and also by giving us an opportunity to go through wonderful activities through Sevadal organizations, tried his best to educate us. When I say educate us, I would like to say that education does not simply mean you need how to read and write. By simply knowing that how you know to read and write, if you consider yourself educated, that's not considered to be the right education at all. Education has got to confer on you certain wonderful qualities. Until and unless those qualities are conferred on us, it's not actually called education. Otherwise, what happens is you become a master of some skills, some subjects, and thereby probably you will exploit the society in such a way that instead of getting sanctified, you will be probably ruining your life by running after wealth, by running after properties, by running after the worldly pleasures and all that. We think we are very smart, and because we have the worldly knowledge, we think we are really enjoying our lives, but the unique opportunity is lost in that process. While speaking to our students, Bhagavan told us on a number of occasions, What is it actually as a student you need to learn? You go to educational institution and then start learning from the school onward to the university. Maybe you are a doctorate, maybe whatever you are. But ultimately, what is the purpose of getting educated, in quotes, education? In the strict sense of the term, Swami on a number of occasions, he said, Satpravartana, Satbuddhi, Satyanirati, Bhakti, Kramasiksha, Kartavya Palanamu, Nirpunadi Vidya, Adnani Vidyardhi Nervavalayu. It is a tall demand actually. It is a tall order. An educated person is supposed to have all these wonderful qualities. Only when you have cultivated all these qualities, you can say that you are educated. Otherwise, maybe in the formal sense, you are educated, but that education is not going to confer the great gift of sanctification. That's not possible. So, what are these wonderful qualities that you are supposed to gain through education? Satpravartana, your behavior. Your behavior has to be exemplary. Don't tell me that your behavior is good. No, good is not accepted actually. It is not enough if your behavior is good. It has got to be exemplary behavior. Sanctification of life is not an ordinary process. Sanctification is a very rich goal. The ultimate goal of life, to sanctify. So, exemplary behavior means in all respects, internal and external, both ways, your behavior is so good. It is fantastic. Sanctifying life is a tall order. And if you don't sanctify your life, what happens is you have to come back again. We never know in which form you are going to come. Swami used to mention to us, you might come as a human being, or maybe you are going to come as an animal or an insect. Maybe you are going to come back as a snake or as a buffalo or a donkey or any other form. And again, you have to go through the cycle. So, it is not enough if you cultivate knowledge. Knowledge has got to be translated into wisdom, extraordinary kind of wisdom. That wisdom actually keeps on telling you from within what is right, what is wrong. You will develop a great sense of discrimination between the good and the bad. What to do, what not to do. What to see, what not to see. What to listen to, what not to listen to. What to speak, what not to speak. What to eat, what not to eat. Bhagavan Baba was very particular even about dressing. Because it is said your dress also will have impact on you. Mostly Bhagavan Baba prescribed all the students and all the staff members and all the people working in his organization to wear a white pant and a white shirt to a large extent, or white color. That color itself grants you peace. You are really peaceful when you are wearing white clothes. So Bhagavan Baba was always guiding us, starting from the beginning of the day till the end of the day, how we do things, how we think, how we work, how we conduct ourselves. That is the reason why it is said satpravartana. Satpravartana, exemplary behavior. When I said external and internal behavior, I mean by internal behavior a very interesting spiritual principle to be cultivated by all of us. Very interesting principle. Swami extensively spoke on this. There is a lot of material available through Vedas and Upanishads on this, which is called as Trikarana Shuddhi. Trikarana Shuddhi is very, very, very important. Manasyekam Vachasyekam Karmanyekam Mahatmanam. Manasyekam Vachasyekam Karmanyekam Mahatmanam. Manas Anyat, Vachas Anyat, Karman Anyat Duratmanam. Somebody need not come and tell me that there is a great variance in my thoughts, in my words, and in my deeds other than myself. I am a proof to it. Because I know I am the best judge of my own self. what I am thinking in my mind, I only can judge. No one else can judge. It's impossible for somebody to read my mind, whether my thoughts are good or not. And when my thoughts are getting translated into actions, whether I'm entering into a righteous action or not. If I'm getting into unrighteous action, then there is no way of sanctifying one's life. And you speak something and you act differently. Nowadays in the modern times, Bhagavan Baba on a number of occasions said that most of the people, they think something, they say something different, and they act totally differently. There is no unisonness in these three. Everybody, it has become a fashion probably in life nowadays. You think something and talk out something. Your thoughts are completely different from what you are speaking. And you act completely differently. And in modern life, you know, most of the people use a word. Whenever we come into contact with them, you know, they say that, sir, he is very smart. What is that smartness? Do you think that deceiving something is smartness? Talking something, speaking something, thinking something, and doing something altogether different, is it smartness? And you think that to be able to enjoy your life in the worldly sense through materialistic prosperity, if you think that you are smart, you are forgetting that spiritually you are ruining yourself. That's not going to give you the calmness which is required. So, inside you have to be the same as you speak out, and you get into the same kind of action as you speak. There must be unisonness between these three important qualities that everybody possesses. Trikarana Shuddhi is a basic point, is a very, very, very important point. If you want to sanctify your life, cultivate Trikarana Shuddhi. There is no other alternative to it. Trikarana Shuddhi. Now, it is important to have control over Arishad Vargas also. Arishad Vargas are the ones actually which destroy one's life. Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Mada, Moha, Matsarya. These are considered to be one's own enemies actually. And Adi Shankaracharya described these Arishad Vargas as one's enemy, and Bhagavan Baba quoted in one of his talks by saying that these enemies, they lie within you. They are always there within you. You can examine yourself whether Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Mada, Moha, Matsarya are bothering me or not. They are bothering you from morning till evening. Either one of them, either Kama either or Krodha either. And Kama, it's not actually understood exactly in the sense of lust or a desire. Kama in the general sense is described as desire for anything is called kama. Desire for anything. Any desire is described in Sanskrit as kama. Kama, don't think that it is having some kind of a lust towards other being or a sensual desire or something. Not exactly that alone. Any desire is called as kama. And now what's it that we are having in the world? Kama has dominated the thinking of people in the modern times to such an extent that they are in the pursuit of wealth all the time. Any amount of wealth, you are not satisfied. Any amount of wealth. Go on gaining more and more and more and more wealth. Bhagavan Baba on a number of times asked a question, how much wealth do you require to lead a comfortable life in this world? How much do you want? Okay, if you say, no, I want to earn more and more because I want my descendants, successors, to inherit all that property. What is the guarantee that they are going to inherit that property? Or even if they are going to inherit, what is the guarantee that they are going to really use it for righteous purposes and for their own spiritual prosperity? Are there any guarantees? Are you going to be a witness to it once you pass away from this world? That means right thinking is not dominating our mind. We are not going through right thinking. Unrighteous thinking is the one which is causing all problems. Look at the nature. Bhagavan Baba hundreds and hundreds of times gave us this example. In fact, we are all what we are today as being chiseled by Swami. Swami was all the time at the act of chiseling us. Every day, day in and day out, he was talking to us. The most important aspect of Bhagavan Baba's mission was Bodha, teaching. He went on teaching, not only us, the entire world. You listen to all his discourses. He was all the time talking about only one thing, that is, you are a divine. Live like a divine being. Don't come down to human level and fall below and become an animal. So we are all below human levels because of our thoughts, because of our actions, because of the kind of knowledge that we are cultivating. We are ruining our lives and we are not sanctifying, whereas the purpose itself is to sanctify. Swami said, you can have hundreds of examples from nature. Nature itself is the best preacher. Even when I was doing my schooling, in my school days, when we were reading Telugu literature, English literature, Hindi literature, there are so many lessons through which values were taught to us. And the values are to be cultivated. It's very, very important. Today, I don't think that we are teaching values. That is the biggest problem. We need to teach more values than anything else. Because only when we cultivate values, it is possible for us to sanctify our lives. If we don't cultivate values, we fall below the human level. That is the biggest problem. In the nature, when Swami was talking about how you sanctify your life, he gave a wonderful example of one beautiful thing that is existing in creation, which we see every minute. That is, Swami said, look at a tree. Look at a tree. Take it as a supreme example of how it sanctifies its life. A tree grows and it gives away itself completely in the service of the nature and also the humans. It doesn't serve itself. It grows and grows and grows. And as it grows, it gives us a lot of oxygen. It gives a lot of flowers. It gives a lot of fruits. It gives great shade. It gives a shelter to so many birds. And it lives and lives and lives by serving and serving and serving. It doesn't eat its fruits. In fact, one poet goes to the extent of describing the generosity of the tree. What is the generosity of the tree? When it bears fruits, I believe, it bends its branches to lower levels to be reachable to human beings. It bends itself. It bends its branches. It brings the branches down so that it is reachable. You can pluck the fruit, eat it, and be happy about it. The ultimate lesson of the tree is it gives away itself completely, totally. Because what happens, you know, once the tree becomes lifeless, what people do is they cut it and they use its body as logs and as firewood. Even after it loses its life, still it serves us. So Swami said, look at the tree every minute and try to learn something from it, how the tree is living. Then Bhagavan gave us the example of cows. How they give milk, taking the grass that is thrown on the roadside, they eat. And do you give actually Bisleri water or anything to cows or what? It drinks whatever water is available on the roadside. And it gives fantastic milk, which is so useful to human beings. What are you specially caring for it? You don't specially care for it. But still the animals, all the animals on the planet work for our benefit. And what we do? Are we really able to reciprocate that kind of loving and sense of giving? without keeping for ourselves? Are we doing really anything to help the nature, to keep the nature, to protect the nature? We are not learning anything. And in the same breath, we were also told that how the clouds conduct themselves, how the clouds actually travel, carrying a lot of water. And they go on raining and raining till the last drop of water is given away to you. And they wither away. In the modern context, a lot of people give the examples of candles. A candle burns and burns and burns and becomes actually formless. But in the process, it gives so much of light. It sanctifies its life. What are we doing? Are we really working for the welfare of anybody in the society? Starting from the family level onwards, we need to question ourselves whether I am selfish by myself by expecting service from every other member in the family. Spiritually speaking, when you are in the family expecting service from every other member, you are not realizing that you are actually burdening yourself with sin. Because you want somebody to serve you all the time. You want your, maybe a wife wants the husbands to serve. A husband wants the wife to serve. Children want actually parents to serve them. Parents, maybe they want children to serve them. Servant maids to serve us. Lots and lots of things. We expect service from every other person in the society. How much are we ready to serve? Are you ready to serve at all, first of all? If we are not ready to serve, how are we sanctifying our lives? Why the question of sanctifying comes into operation at all is because Bhagavan Baba on a number of occasions said that you are what you are because of the society. Lot of teachers taught me. Many doctors treated me. They gave me health. Teachers gave me wisdom. My parents loved me. They gave me a lot of things, sacrificing their own welfare. All kinds of facilities are given to me. The society is the one which gives me roads. The society is the one which gives educational institutions, universities, transport facilities, communication facilities. All are provided to me by the society. What am I giving in return to the society? Today we are expecting lots and lots of things from the society without giving anything to the society. This is where Bhagavan Baba's philosophy comes into operation. And Bhagavan Baba's avatar itself stands out as a supreme example of giving and giving and giving. Because Bhagavan Baba, he showed his hand while giving public discourses to all the people. He raised his hand and said, "This hand knows only how to give. It doesn't know how to receive," he said. And in the same breath, Swami also declared, "My life is my message." When he said, "My life is my message," how did he live? We need to contemplate on this. We need to think on this. How did he live? By giving and giving and giving. All his life he went on giving and giving and giving. I am a witness to a wonderful project run by Bhagavan Baba, which we are all aware, the water project. But there are certain fascinating facts about this water project. When the water project was on, Swami was very busy planning it, guiding the multinational company how to undertake it, how to execute it, and lot of financial implications, lots of things. He was very, very busy thinking on all those things. And every day as the project began, one group or the other was always present in Prashantanalayam from nearby villages, towns, universities, one place or the other, everywhere. Lot of people were coming to Parthi. They were sitting in darshan lines and Swami would ask them, "Bangaru, how is it? How are you here? Why are you all here?" They would say, "Swami, the water project is just going 5 kilometers away from our village, Swami, just 5 kilometers. If our village is also connected, we will also get water, Swami. Really, there is no water at all for decades and decades and decades. Kindly shower your grace." And immediately Swami would call the executioners of the project and he would say, "Connect their village also." And we need to think connecting the village is going to be expensive. There is a lot of cost involved in it. And when people raised Swami cost is, you know, he said, give. Give, give. I still remember the Krishnadevaraya University entire staff, Vice Chancellor, Registrar, all people were here requesting Swami, Swami, please give us water. Give. Give and give and give. And you know, all of you are aware how actually our medical projects are going on. No charge at all. Educational institutions free. Everything. Give, give, give. And Swami asked, did nature ever question you to give anything to it? It is serving so very nicely, all of you. Wind is blowing, the fire burns, water is available, everything. Are you paying any rent to all this natural phenomena? Simply love, love, love. It is teaching love. But you cultivated the habit of exploiting everything that is existing around you, whether that exploitation is required or not, and beyond levels. Probably what we call education in modern times has really harmed us. Education really did not deliver the kind of wisdom that we are supposed to cultivate. And by calling ourselves educated, we are insulting what is called as education. We need to educate ourselves on the right lines so that we sanctify. What is it that you have to do ultimately? Ultimately, what you need to do is, through education, you have to love everything existing around. It is love. The mantra is love. That's why Swami gave us, in a beautiful, simple sentence, love all, serve all. Love all, serve all. Now, when we talk about this wonderful Vedic dictum-like statement given by Swami, love all and serve all, we need to question ourselves, am I loving all? Am I serving all? You have to ask a question. Are you really loving all people around you? Or do you have, say for example, some kind of jealousy towards others? Or any other kind of feelings towards others which are negative in nature? And then Bhagavan Baba said, you need to ask yourself a question. Why? Why am I jealous of others? Why? Do you have an answer for that? In one context, Bhagavan Baba said, people take great pleasure in criticizing others. Unrighteous criticism. If it is criticism for the welfare of others with the intention that I want that person to spiritually progress, that criticism is welcomed. In Dharma Shastras, it is clearly said, the ministers of the yesteryears, standing by the side of the emperor or the king, they are not supposed to be there all the time to praise the king only. In modern times, we say people around doing bhajan. Bhajana parulu, the people who keep on extolling you for everything, whether it is right or wrong. In Dharma Shastra, it is clearly said that such people are dangerous actually. Such people are very dangerous. You should avoid the company of such people. It is clearly said. Swami always told us, if people are there 24 hours praising, there is a problem. Why? If they are praising, what happens, you know? They are not able to bring out the drawbacks in you, the demerits in you are not focused. They are not able to bring out. And they are praising you for unnecessary things as well. This is not right. If you have real love for a right person, for the person, and you want him spiritually to progress, what you need to do is, you have to point out in clear crystal terms where he is going wrong and where he has to correct himself. That is education. That's right education. So the king was always advised to have ministers who are fearless, jnanis, they are all people of great wisdom. They will always put the king on the right track, right road. In the same way, teachers. Teachers are supposed to do that. Then what happens? You give them the right wisdom. If you give them the right wisdom, they will sanctify their lives because they will be on the path of righteousness. Love is very, very, very important, and love has got positive energy. You love somebody. When you love somebody, the condition or the precondition to love is don't expect anything in return for loving. That's very, very important. That's the reason why in Bhagavad Gita, it is clearly said, Karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. You need to perform your duty without expecting anything in turn. Bhagavan Baba was doing all the time. So much he was doing, there were never any expectations. In fact, Swami has gone to the extent of declaring himself to our students once, talking to them. I was a witness to that talk. I was there on that day when Bhagavan Baba said that. And probably I was a bit hurt also when Bhagavan Baba said that. Why, Swami, we make God come onto the earth and speak like this to us? Swami said, Bangaru, meeru nammina nammakapoyina Swami ki inta kuda swardham ledu, Swami said. Whether you believe me or not, I don't have even this much of selfishness, Swami said. We make God speak like that because of our behavior. If we are not actually correcting ourselves and putting ourselves on the right track and live like good human beings. We are human beings. And Swami many times said, Nuvu akara manavuduve kani achara manavudu kadu, he said. You are only in form a human being. Are you really in your actions, you are a human being? Are you conducting yourself like a human being? Animals are much better, he said. Animals are behaving much better than human beings. There is a reason why Swami talked about dogs being faithful. Why is it that we give actually the example of dog when we talk about faithfulness? And many times we say, dog is much better than you. Why? A cow is much better than you. A donkey is much better than you. What is this kind of comments that we hear when we are not able to love our own brethren, our own brothers and sisters, and we are not going to work without any selfishness in us? So Swami said, these qualities that are there in you are playing a very dominant role in modern times. Kama, krodha, lobha, mada, moha, matsaryas. While talking to us on kama, krodha, lobha, mada, moha, matsaryas, how actually the love in you is killed by these qualities, Swami gave us examples from our Puranas. He gave three examples for three qualities. Straight away. It is like actually a research scholar doing research on a very great epic and coming out with the essence of it in one sentence. Swami was talking to teachers one day and he said, I'll give you examples, he said, how these are very dangerous qualities. In that context only, Swami said, Shankaracharya once observed about these Arishadvarkas and said, these Arishadvargas are within you like thieves, sitting within you. And whenever you take a pill of wisdom, some piece of wisdom, you take it, it goes into you, immediately it is stolen by these thieves. They will not allow it to shine. So any kind of act of wisdom or piece of knowledge of wisdom enters you, it is swallowed by these Arishadvargas in you, they will not allow it to blossom in you. They are called thieves sitting in you. Jnana Ratna Paharaya. The diamonds of wisdom are within you. They are going, you are taking in, but these people are not allowing them to blossom. Now what you need to do is, you have to have good control over these Arishadvargas. And as I just now mentioned, Swami gave us three examples from three epics and said how dangerous, how powerful these Arishadvargas are. He gave first of all the example of Kama, how dangerous it is, how it kills your humanness and your divine qualities are not allowed to blossom because you will not be able to love when these Arishad Varga's dominate. Kama, he gave the example of Ravana. Ravana is considered as the most brilliant man, who was a master of Vedas. He was a master of Upanishads. He was a great warrior. He was greatly handsome. And he conquered everything in the world. He was a very great scholar. He in fact actually gave tune to Vedas. He was such a very great person. He demanded darshan of Sadashiva. He said, Swami, you have to give me darshan. Sadashiva, he sakaramuga, pratyakshamuga, directly he saw through his penance. Such a very great man. One quality, kama, because of that, it is not that just Ravana perished, his entire clan perished, the whole Rakshasa jati perished because of that. That is the potential, dangerous potentiality of kama. So Swami said, kama is so dangerous, it will ruin the entire dynasty. So you keep yourself away. And then Swami gave the example of Krodha, Hiranyakashipu. Krodha. What happened with Hiranyakashipu, we know. The whole dynasty was destroyed because of Krodha. Lobha. Swami gave the example of Mahabharata. What did Duryodhana say? Duryodhana said, that much of land where actually a point of a needle occupies, even that much land I will not give to Pandavas, he said. Lobha. It is so very dangerous. And it led to the destruction of all the Kauravas. The whole Kaurava dynasty was destroyed. It is not that we do not know. Swami always said that you know all these are there within you. Within every human being, all these are there. And the spiritual description, the research that went onto these Arishad Vargas, and the ultimate conclusion given is, it seems you can never conquer these qualities. It is impossible. These qualities cannot be conquered. Because they will be waiting for opportunities staying within you. They will be waiting for an opportunity. Whenever an opportunity comes across, they just immediately raise their ugly hood and take over you. Swami said they are very, very powerful, very potential. You cannot conquer them. What you can do? Said, you can see to it that these qualities are subdued. You can subdue them. When you subdue all these qualities, there is peace within you. The most important thing is, these Arishad Vargas have got volcanic nature. They are like a volcano, ready to blow. Now you have to keep them under control. Subdue them. You can subdue them only by mastering all the scriptures and cultivating positive energy, which is possible through wonderful kind of wisdom that we need to accomplish. For this, Swami said, discriminative quality you have to develop. Discrimination. When we say Jantunam Narajanma Durlabham, Swami said, you are also like other animals, but the only thing that distinguishes you from other animals is your discriminative capacity. It is only human beings actually who can think what is good, what is bad, what is right, what is wrong. You have to discriminate. Not only you have to discriminate, Swami said, there is a mantra, a beautiful mantra Swami gave us. To have all these qualities under control. Everything will come under your control with this mantra. That mantra is self-resistance, he said. Restrain is the mantra. Restrain, 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 all the time restrain. You have to restrain yourself from those things which are likely to cause disturbance to you, which are likely to cause problems to you, which are likely to cause frustration to you. You have to restrain yourself from that. Because Swami brought out some fundamental facts with reference to human nature and put those in front of us. He placed all those facts in front of us. One fundamental fact, a very, very interesting fact, which is given to us through Vedas and Upanishads, and Swami quoted this a number of times and presented it to us. It is for us to use that. Swami gave us that wisdom, and it is for us to utilize it. Swami quoted by saying, Manayeva manushyanam karanam bandhamokshayo. A number of times Swami quoted and explained to us. What does it mean? Manayeva manushyanam karanam bandhamokshayo. Among human beings, it is the manaha, mind, is responsible either for your bondage or for your liberation. You get bound to the world if you become materialistic. You get released from the world if you become spiritual. The choice is yours. Do you want to turn to one side, toward the world side, and get caught in the world? Or do you want to turn towards the spiritual world and get relieved by committing yourself to values? And if somebody is going to say that, sir, this very, very tough game, Ramayana time, Bharata time, don't talk about Pandavas, Rama, Krishna and all that. Do you think it is possible in modern times? Bhagavan himself gave a number of examples. Swami extolled the qualities of a number of people in modern times. Swami talked about Abdul Kalam. Swami talked about Lal Bahadur Shastri. Swami talked about Bal Gangadhar Tilak. So many people are available in the world to us. And you know how they lived. When the former president, no more now, late president of India, Abdul Kalam walked out of the Rashtrapati Palace, he walked out with one briefcase, that's all. And he gave away all his money in charity to everybody. While we are busy accumulating so much, so much, so much. Why are we like this? And we consider ourselves as something totally different and great. No, 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 not at all. So the most important thing is, how do you restrain yourself every minute? Whenever a thought is coming in your mind, you should immediately decide on that thought, whether it is good or bad, whether it is good for your spiritual progress or not. And all the thoughts which are not good for your spiritual progress, restrain, stop them immediately. Nip them in the bud. Don't allow those thoughts to take the form of action. That is the most important thing. So now, how do you explain these thoughts? Swami gave us again, while explaining, Manayeva manushyanam karanam bandhamokshayo. It is mind which you put towards spiritual road, not toward the material world. Stop it. Then keep on loving, 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 loving. Unconditionally go on loving. And the most beautiful aspect of Swami's teaching on love is, do you love only those people who love you? Swami said, even stupids do it. What is so special about you then? Swami said, if you are able to love somebody who doesn't love you, if you are able to love somebody who is jealous of you, if you are able to pray for the welfare of somebody who is praying for your downfall, then you become a right good human being. Are we really thinking on those lines? Are we having that much of control over our mind? So Swami gave another principle. It is the mind which plays the game all the time. And he described in his discourses his monkey mind. This monkey mind always attracts you toward the world. It doesn't allow you toward the spiritual path. So mind also, in Patanjali Yoga Sutras, a beautiful sutra Swami quoted always and said, what is mind actually? Mind has got only one business. The business of the mind is to drag you into this world. And now what you have to do? Cultivate some kind of yoga, he said. Yoga doesn't mean simply practicing yogasanas and all that. That is a part of it. But there is something much more than that, according to Patanjali. Swami quoted Patanjali Yoga Sutras also. Yogaha Chitta Vritti Nirodhakaha. Yogaha Chitta Vritti Nirodhakaha.
yoga is not only yogasanas, which will give you a good, stable, strong body, but what about the mind part of it? You are not actually the body alone. If you are only the body, there is no problem at all. There is another problem, more important problem, that is your mind, manaha. So yoga, body, keep the body straight, strong, good, healthy. But then there is another part of it. Yoga, chitta vritti nirodha. Chitta is mind. Vritti, business of mind. Nirodhakaha, the one which is able to have good control over the business of the mind, is yoga. What is the business of mind? Business of mind is to 24 hours rock you with thoughts. Millions and millions of thoughts. I am talking to you. Maybe my mind is actually expecting a cup of tea now. Yes, maybe my mind is near a tea shop. Maybe my mind is in the market. It wants vegetables. Maybe my mind is on the road asking me to take a walk. At the same time, your mind is such a very powerful thing. It throws up millions and millions and millions of thoughts. And Swami said, how you control these thoughts, that is yoga. So you need to have good control over your thoughts. Control the mind, that is possible through two things. According to Bhagavad Gita, which again Swami quoted, in life you have to cultivate those things. What are those two things which you have to utilize? Abhyasa and Vairagya. These are the two things. In ashram, Bhagavan Baba teaches us 24 hours, Abhyasa Vairagya. Abhyasa Vairagya. What is Abhyasa and Vairagya? In ashram, he will make everybody be happy with a simple accommodation. If you want, you can have a huge accommodation. But Swami says, you want to be with me? It'll be a small accommodation. And you'll have to take small breakfast, small lunch, small dinner. And you'll go to bed very early. You get up very early in the morning. Nagar Sankirtan, bhajans, darshan, abhyasa. Every day, put your mind and ask it to do, it will do that. All of you do one thing. Take a decision today. That every day you must go to mandir in the evening around 7 o'clock and spend 15 minutes there. Take a decision, go there every day. After 1 month, one day when you are dodging, your mind will say, come on, take me there, take me there, take me there. Your mind will force you to be there. Because abhyasa. So, in human life, the most important thing is we should cultivate the mind. We should control the mind. We should have good control over the mind. Abhyasa and vairagya, detachment. Be happy with what you are. There are millions and millions of people, Swami told us a number of times, who don't have anything at all. You are having so much compared to those people. So you should learn contentment and control over mind. In that context, Swami said, mind is like a monkey mind. It is a very dangerous thing. So what you need to do is master the mind, be a master mind. Master the mind, be a master mind. Teach your mind to love and love and love and love. Expansion, expand, expand, expand. Whenever bad thoughts come to your mind, Swami always asked us. He told us, our students, our staff members, everybody in ashram, everybody, all devotees, he said, you ask yourself a question. Why am I getting bad thoughts? Why am I looking at bad things? Why I want to listen to bad things? Ask yourself the question. Ask, ask, ask. All the time, keep on asking questions. Answer the questions yourself. After some time, you will definitely stop all those things and come onto the positive track, which will actually put you on the track of love. Love and love and love. You should tell yourself, let me love everybody. Let me love everybody. Why should I hate somebody? What is the use? If I am jealous of somebody, what is the use? There's no use of all these things. It harms you. So Swami said, ask yourself a number of questions whenever you are onto the negative domain. Drag yourself onto the positive domain. Cultivate it. Keep mastering the mind. Have control over the mind. Put it on that and be contented. Be comfortable. Then you will begin to love and love and love. That is the royal path to sanctify our lives. Swami taught us this. I think we can do it. And keep on praying to Bhagavan to give us the strength to do that. I thank you very, very much for this wonderful opportunity. Jai Sai Ram.